All right. Welcome to Florida. Woohoo. I'm just curious, random weird poll. How many have moved to Florida in recent years? And recent can be relative. In the last couple years. I'm just curious. All right, interesting. How many moved to Florida because of a tech job or some tech thing? Just curious, huh? Yeah? Okay. How many moved to Florida because it's just awesome? That's me. Okay, all right, fair enough. all right, so my talk is on performance, user experience, and sustainability, specifically fisheries sustainability. And I'm going to use that as an illustration to talk about performance metrics and applications. And really just talking about performance-driven mindset, but driven by user use cases. So if I were to summarize what I want you to walk out with today, I would say in all the hustle and bustle of work, getting things to be performant and to work, don't forget why you're doing it and who you're doing it for. And also, this talk's kind of meant to not be linear, like a traditional lecture. It's kind of like, you know that meme of that guy with the funny hair, and he's like doing this, and in the back, there's like these post-it notes like that, and you know that meme is like conspiracy meme or whatever. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to do that. We're going to have a couple little post-it notes with things, and we're going to tie it together as we go. So just if you let me do that, I think it'll make sense towards the end. So my name's Rick Blalock. I grew up here in Jupiter, Florida, just an hour and a half north of here. I keep forgetting that people don't know that that's a town. So a couple people earlier yesterday, I'm like, I'm from Jupiter. And they're like, yeah, right, Rick, whatever. I'm from Mars. I'm like, no, it's actually a town. there's some links and handles and things up there. But one thing to focus that I want to highlight is I started a company with my co-founder Aubrey a few years ago as a side project called Fish Rules. And Fish Rules is an app that helps anglers. Fishermen, fisherwomen, fish without fear, to help them stay legal, to know the regulations, really a fun thing, and to help fishery sustainability and some of the science that goes behind it. So started that. I went full-time on that a little over a year ago. I left a job at a startup in Austin to go full-time on it. And, you know, focus is important. Anytime you can focus, all of a sudden things happen. And things started to take off. We started growing really great. And then in December of last year, we were acquired by a company called Fishbrain, which is the largest digital fishing kind of property in the world. So now I'm working at Fishbrain. So that's something to note there. Now, the first kind of pin on our board I want to talk about is application performance and how we talk about it. You know, there's a bunch of things we say that we look at, that we prioritize. There's some, everybody has probably said something like this, right? All of these are super important. They're vital. But what I want to highlight is how we talk about them is insider's baseball. It's which is fine. We all communicate on a medium that, you know, if you went to an accounting conference and they started using accounting terms, we'd all be like, what in the world are they talking about? Same thing with performance metrics. It's insider's baseball. And hopefully I show you some examples of why sometimes we forget why we're actually doing it, why we're doing it. So you say, Rick, well, what do you mean? What are you talking about? Well, if I show this slide, this is one of those common language things. We all kind of know what this is, a lighthouse score, right? We're used to seeing this. We talk about it, regardless if that title matches with this or not. But it's a common thing that we talk about, and it's common to us, well-versed to us in this room. But what if I switch the context? I'm going to switch the context. It's meant to be a little silly, and you're going to roll your eyes at me. That's okay. I'm used to it. But what if we frame things differently? What if I use this title, and this is one of, actually it's my co-founder's brother, but it's also one of our customers, an angler. Well, that doesn't make much sense, right? That's kind of weird. It's like, Rick, this is out of context. Right, exactly. What about this? This is a Ukrainian soldier using a laptop allegedly connected to Starlink communicating with the drone. Well, I guess that matters. It does matter, but it's a little out of context. Oh, this one certainly is. It looks like a red grouper. I think it's a red grouper. This is a reef off of Jupiter. Jupiter, Florida. That red grouper doesn't care about that. I'll use some more illustrations on that in a minute. But all these are important things, but just with changing a picture from the lighthouse to something like this, the conversation is framed differently. From an engineering perspective, we're used to talking about it in insider baseball terms, but we forget how to tie it to the value it brings to the user, or in this case, to a fish. But saying, oh, well, it makes the user happy, or they won't leave the site as much, that's good, you're right, and that's generic. And actually even saying things like, well, we're trying to make the Google bots happy. That's generic too. But what I'm trying to emphasize is tying it back to the user. So let's talk about why we do it. And Lee, I stole your slide. I asked permission to use it. You gave me a smiley face. Okay, he's giving me thumbs up, so that's great. I love this slide, by the way. It's amazing. And so platforms, Vuejs, let's use Vuejs and Next.js, I guess if you could call it a platform. But Google is another example, and other platforms, they deal in things that are irreducible minimums because they deal in value abstraction. They try to, like Google is a great example in the lighthouse stuff and all these things. They're trying to find what's the key metrics that we can apply across the web that benefits, well, really, frankly, firstly, it benefits the business, right, in their organization, but also generically benefits users across the board. And they're also really good at educating us about these. They're very good at it. So as a result, that's how we talk about it, and that's how we talk about the value. And they're right. They're 100% right on that value. But again, hopefully we'll see. We're going to tie some things into users here. The other thing is, because we're so used to insider baseball speak within our own bubble, our own groups, we're not accustomed to talking about it in other terms. It's hard for us to talk about the value of this stuff in terms outside of what we've been told. And that's actually, honestly, and we'll talk about measurement in a minute, it's because it's harder to measure. Somebody's done the hard work and figured out how to measure things and given us tools. Actually, honestly, Next.js and Vuejs, both of them together, it's amazing. It's magic. And they've done so much work to where it's like you hit a button, you do a couple things, and you get a bunch of stuff out of the box that would have taken sprints and sprints and sprints to do. But because we're so used to that, we're used to talking just to that, and we don't ever try to tie it back to the user. And we'll talk about why that's a problem in a minute. Third reason, we are caught up in the details. We are caught up on optimizing third-party scripts and all these things, that's our job, right? We have to do that. That's important as an expert, as a craftsman and woman in our industry. It's very important. But sometimes being caught up in the work, you forget why you're doing the work. And the fourth thing is, why this happens, is we don't talk to users. Or we don't talk about Bruno, no. So let's stick a pin in that. Again, and let's move on to the next thing. So just really quickly, because I want to use fish rules as an illustration. So if you just allow me to use fishing stories as illustrations and be like a stereotypical Florida fisherman, that'd be great. So fish rules is an app that helps anglers stay legal. I mentioned that. And it might sound like a silly thing, but it's actually a huge problem. Doesn't matter if you're a novice or an expert. It's one common problem. And it has sustainability ramifications. It's really important that we have fish in the ocean and that my kids have fish in the ocean and their kids have fish in the ocean. And regulations is the way to manage those fisheries to make sure that they replenish. So it's really important. So that's what we do. And then, of course, now we're acquired by Fishbrain, and now all of the regulations and our data and other things are now in Fishbrain as well, which is awesome. And just since we're in Florida, I'll give you a couple little random Florida tidbits about fishing. So recreational fishing in Florida, it's larger than the space industry. It's larger than the citrus industry. It's larger than the cattle industry here. 20 million people come to Florida every year just to fish. It's the fishing destination in the world. I think Florida DEP released something interesting. Coral reefs just in this area of Florida, in southeast Florida, is an $8.5 billion generator of money in local sales and things like that. And 70,000 jobs here in southeast Florida are directly related to just the value that coral bring. So I could go on and on. There's 1 out of 7 Americans that fish. If sport fishing was its own corporation, it would be number 54 ahead of Cisco, all that kind of stuff. So anyway, I want to use this as an illustration, if you let me. So stick a pin in that, and we'll move on. Back to our point, what is all that mumbo-jumbo about performance metrics, which are important, what does it do for the angler? This is my business partner. He did his he has a PhD in something with fish, and he did his graduate studies on the Amazon, and that's him with the peacock bass in some really super cool canoe. But what does all that have to do with this? Like, what does it actually do to the angler? Does it help me convert a user to a subscription better? Yeah, it does. We have a subscription service in FishRules. Does it help us sell e-commerce on FishBrain better? Yeah, absolutely, it does, of course. But it's deeper than that. Don't just think about terms, the irreducible minimums that the platforms talk about it. It's not their job to figure out the value that's tied back to your user or to your business. So just to give you an illustration, I got to hurry through this stuff. When we were building the app, I was on a boat in the middle of the ocean in between here and the Bahamas with him, with Aubrey, and I had my laptop on my lap where everybody's fishing on the boat, and except me because I'm working, and I've got a device plugged in, and we're testing out the point and polygon algorithm. So we're going in and out of different regulation boundaries, testing it to see how well it works with good signal, bad signal, all this stuff. And they catch a cobia. And this is a big cobia, like everybody's going to be eating and their families are going to be eating tonight. It's awesome. We're all excited. We're testing the app out. He pulls the app out, and it takes too long to load the regulation. He throws the fish back. We all know it's legal and we're allowed to keep it. And Aubrey goes, "That app is too slow. If I would have waited, that fish would have suffocated and died." And he threw it back. And we're all like, "What did you do? You just threw dinner away." The point is, I could have sat there and been like, "Look, reason, Aubrey, the reason is because the point and polygon algorithm, it's optimized, but you know, we use React Native and we query the database, we get these polygons out, and there's like millions of points, and it comes across the bridge, and then I got to deserialize it, and then I got to run the algorithm, and then I got to do that for 10 other." And he's going, "Dude, can I keep it or not? Is it, you know, we know this, right? We know this. It matters. And actually, it actually matters to it with developer experience too. You can actually tie developer experience back to user value too. We won't go into that. Okay, so stick a pin in that. Let's go to next layer. Next layer, how about our company? How about business and product people? That's the next layer deeper than just the users. So let's talk about how engineers go, "Well, we need, you know, X performance 3000. And the product guys and the business guys go, "These typical developers who just want the latest, greatest, newest thing, and they're trying to blame it on some slow thing." And it's not articulated well enough, because it's not tied to a user value that they can understand. They don't fully understand it. So, like, back to the sequence diagram, they don't get it. These engineers don't get it. We need to do this. The users care about this, and they're trying to do their little homework thing. No. You didn't tie it back. But when you start talking with the user's voice, all of a sudden, things change. All of a sudden, the people in a product and an engineering organization that have power, influence, are the ones that speak with the user's voice, either through shared experience with them, conversations, stories, or study, which you can do that too. So how do we speak with the user's voice? How do we do that? Well, the first easy, obvious thing is you talk to them. And if you can't talk, and there's a whole, by the way, there's a great book called Continuous Discovery Habits. I encourage you to read that book. Excellent book, and she establishes a lot of this stuff. But just talk to them. And if you can't talk to them, which is viable, sometimes that's possible, in a bigger organization especially, find someone that is talking to them. And if that's not possible, find them online. Find out, yeah, there's an engineering manager at this company I'm at FishBrain. I really appreciate his approach. He needed some more information on how anglers find fishing spots. And he started going on YouTube and watching. There's a whole series of videos on anglers using Google Earth to find fishing spots. And they'll zoom in on a lake, and they'll scrub through time, and they'll see how like vegetation grows and ebbs and flows of water. And so that's a case where he couldn't talk to a user, but he just went to Google, to YouTube, and he figured it out. He found out more information than some of the other people knew about how people find fishing spots. Talk to the users. It helps the business, and it helps the product people tie the value. If you want to transform your site into, for example, Next.js, if you're wanting to do that and you're like, oh, we're going to have to do one page at a time, tie it back to user value. You can't just be talking about performance metrics, insider baseball, and expect a win all the time. All right, so stick a pin in that. And, you know, down here are some things, some performance metrics. Most of us are familiar with them. All the way down to even UX laws like Hick's Law and the Daugherty Threshold, all of those things. But if you're using those terms, just keep in mind the business and product people might not understand it, and they might think you don't get it. So tie it back to the user. Stick a pin in that. Real quick, let's talk about, I got 3 minutes here, so some traps on measurability of things. Measurability of bias is the tendency to prefer options simply because they are more easily measured. In other words, someone did all this hard work for me, and I can get this really easy, so this is what I'm going to use to talk about the value we're bringing. That's called measurability bias. And what happens is, since it's so easy to do, we have this idea, we'll just amass more and more and more and more and more and more, and then we'll give it over to product and business, and we'll say, look at all this data. And they go, okay, what does that mean? What's it? So there's a great quote from the book Tyranny of Metrics. I encourage everybody to read that book. It's not mainly about engineering performance. It's about, in metrics, it's about like performance metrics for humans, behavioral metrics. There's a great quote. There is an unexamined faith that amassing metric data and sharing it widely within an organization will result in improvements of some sort. That's a trap. The other one is metric fixation, focusing on one metric at the detriment of everything else. Or, in our case, we're focusing on these metrics we know will help, but we forget, we got to tie it to this user over here. That's hard to do. How am I going to do that? And so because of that, we're like, we're just going to focus on this. These kind of like are a feedback loop here. Here's just some quotes again from that book. Once we become fixated on measurement, we slip into believing that more of the same is better. And it occurs because not everything that is important is measurable, and much that is measurable is unimportant. So let's close this out here. Just three things just to think about in our pinboard of ideas. So the first thing is tie things back to users. Hopefully you heard that several times today. things constantly change in an organization, if you're in a startup especially. But if you're anchored with the user, you understand why your company exists and why you're trying to do what you're doing, my goodness, your work is so much more easily explained to people. Second thing is responsibility. Work to understand how performance affects users, the business, the product, and don't get put into a corner. Don't put yourself in a corner. Well, we're engineering, Rick, and you know, product needs to come up with these, and business needs to, they need to understand. And you know, in some context, I would agree with you, in some context. But with this specific one, at least what I've seen in organizations that I've worked in and been around and helped, engineers have to win this battle. And when you win the battle is when you talk about it from the user's perspective. Take responsibility, knowing the downstream, upstream effects of performance work, how they affect the business, the user. And the third thing is value your work. You know, don't limit the value of what you're doing on performance work to just like, well, I work for 4 sprints and I've made the site 200 milliseconds faster. What am I even doing with my life? You know, that's not what, but if you tie it to the user, your work has an outcome and it has an actual end value. That's awesome. I work so hard for these point polygon algorithms to work better and this and this and this, and now there's fish that aren't going to die needlessly because because it's fast enough. And there's an angler that can eat dinner tonight because I worked hard at that part. That's where, tie it to that. Tie your work to that. And when you're doing that, when you impact the world and you think about it that way, you know, we got a 1 second query speed improvement with our data pipeline this quarter. That's good, but you just impacted somebody's life. How? How did you do it? How did you impact, in case of fish rules again, help protect an endangered species, something like that. Tie it to that, think about it that way, talk about it that way, and I promise you'll see a lot better adoption in your company or like, hey, do this more, do this more. All right, thank you, everybody.
Oh, wow, and then you... All right.